The Dead Next Door is a 1989 zombie movie by writer, director, actor, composer, and explosives expert J.R. Bookwalter. It was produced by Sam Raimi under a pseudonym, and Bruce Campbell voiced two of the characters. Yeah, you heard that correctly. Two of the actors' voices were just straight up replaced by Bruce Campbell's voice. The film opens with a scientist and his daughter hiding from a gang of thugs out to get them. You can tell he's a scientist on account of his scientist coat. The thugs manage to break in and are promptly attacked by zombies. After that, Mr. Bookwalter wastes no time throwing us right into the action. We've got zombies in the streets, zombies at the video store, zombies everywhere. But fear not, the zombie squad rolls up to begin taking care of this heinous epidemic. Led by their fearless leader, Raimi. Yeah, his name is Raimi, and he's voiced by Bruce Campbell. There's a ton of names in this movie that are references to horror icons like Savini and Romero. It's extremely on the nose, but whatever. It's cool that he's paying tribute to those he's inspired by, I guess. So, the Zom Squad starts by very casually checking out this home that has been attacked by zombies. This guy goes off on his own to eliminate a zombie upstairs that's just chilling and having some lunch. He shoots it in the head, but that doesn't work, so he goes in with his government-issued machete instead. He almost gets chomped by another zombie that was hiding in the closet behind him, but Raimi enters and shoves a grenade in its mouth, and they chuck it out the window. So, just one quick thing I'd like to address. Bookwalter made the bold choice when writing this film to have the elite zombie squad composed entirely of complete fucking idiots. These guys seem to have zero training and even zero spatial awareness through the entirety of the movie. It is funny, but also just straight baffling. Oh, look, here comes an example right now. This fucking Goomba leans over to grab his weapon and shoves his hand directly into the mouth of the zombie's severed head. It, unsurprisingly, chomps his fucking fingers off. So these guys all simultaneously agree to leave this guy behind without really any discussion or anything at all. Even he agrees without arguing whatsoever. So they ditch their poor boy and head back to HQ. They go have a chat with Dr. Molson, who is experimenting on zombies and apparently working on a way to eliminate the virus. He tells them about this guy, Dr. Bo, who created the serum that started the whole zombie epidemic in the first place. They need to go to find Dr. Bo's serum so Molson can reverse engineer a cure. In another example of the zombie squad's complete ineptitude, this guy, Mercer, just stands too close to a restrained zombie in the lab and gets bitten. They obviously like Mercer a lot more than the last guy that got bitten because they keep him around while they go to find Dr. Bo's serum. So the squad rolls up on Dr. Bo's lab. He was the scientist guy at the beginning, by the way. They crack open the door and a whole bunch of zombos attack him. They manage to fight him off and this kid runs out of the woods asking for help. So they bring him in, close the door, and hole up in Dr. Bo's place with their new buddy. His name is Vincent and he tells them he's from some local church group. Raimi and Girl explore the house and find Dr. Bo's corpse and his daughter's diary, but no sign of her. The next morning, the crew is having a pleasant picnic outside, which is a normal thing to do during a zombie apocalypse. From a distance, Dog the Bounty Hunter spies on them with his binoculars. Vincent tells the squad that his church group is devoted to protecting zombies rather than killing them, and he makes some pretty strong points to back that up.
No, that's not true. It is my religion that is right.
Back inside Dr. Bo's place, Dr. Molson tracks down the Krabby Patty secret formula. Dr. Bo's zombie formula. When Vincent hears that the zombie squad's prime directive is to eliminate all zombos, he loses it and machetes this guy in the shoulder. Raimi shoots him as he runs off, but he gets in a car and escapes. Vincent gets back to his church colony and warns the leader, Reverend Jones, about the zombie squad's plan. Then he dies. Raimi and Mercer roll up on the colony and poke around for a little bit. They see that the church people are keeping zombies in cages, including the Reverend's own zombified son who he keeps in his office, and they're also performing evil sacrificial rituals. Raimi makes a profound observation.
It's a damn cult.
Dr. Molson and his vaguely Stephen King-looking assistant manage to put together their antivirus serum, but, shucks, they need a zombie to test it on. So Raimi and Girl take off to go get a zombie. Dr. Molson decides to give his serum to Mercer right away, though, to stop him from becoming a zombie. Raimi and Girl kidnap the Reverend's zombie son and bring him back to the lab. Molson injects the zombie son with the serum as well. Meanwhile, the cult gets ready to go to war with the zombie squad, to avenge Vincent's death and to get their zombie back. The cult rolls up on Dr. Bo's lab. The squad manages to kill a few cult members and then they escape, but they just forget to bring Mercer with them. It's honestly incredible. There's literally no other reason provided.
Damn it! How in the hell could we have forgotten Mercer?
Can't we go back and get him?
It's too risky with the cult back there.
Oops, we forgot our friend. So, now they gotta go back to the cult's home base to rescue Mercer. Back at the cult's base, Reverend Jones is holding a sermon, complete with his zombie son and Mercer on stage with him. Raimi, Girl, and the two unarmed scientists saunter up completely unopposed, and assistant to Dr. Molson walks right up on stage to rescue Mercer. Suddenly, the Reverend's zombie son melts into mush, which is apparently what the serum is supposed to do to zombies, so Dr. Molson is satisfied that it works. But it looks like the serum may have had unintended side effects on Mercer, such as scary face, deep voice, and good manners.
Thank you for removing that, Franklin.
The Reverend shoots Science Boy and Raimi shoots the Reverend. The cultists then decide to chase the Zom Squad, who lightly jog away from them. The wounded Reverend decides to open his secret zombie vault and unleash all of his pet zombies. Meanwhile, Mercer decides that Dr. Molson is his primary target, because he doesn't appreciate what the doctor's serum has turned him into. Molson flees Mercer and hides out in an office, where he makes a phone call back to base to relay the ingredients of his serum before the zombies break down the door. Dr. Molson tries to warn them not to use the serum on humans that have yet to become zombies, otherwise they turn into ultra-zombies like Mercer. But before he can do that, the zombies break in. Molson locks himself in a flimsy wooden cage to protect himself. It doesn't work. Raimi gets chomped on his way out of the compound, but manages to escape along with Girl. Mercer sees them off, satisfied that he got his revenge on Molson. Back at base, these fucking idiots give Raimi Molson's serum, and he turns into a super zombo just like Mercer. Then we get this honestly hilarious ending where he gets into his vehicle, which is now labeled Human Squad, and he drives off into the sunset along with his new zombie buds. So, there you have it. That's The Dead Next Door. I genuinely have a hard time articulating exactly how I feel about this movie, because it's hard to admit just how much I enjoyed this deeply flawed piece of cinema. I mean, objectively speaking, it has very few redeeming qualities. Horrible acting.
That's it. It's done.
Yes, it is.
Horrible dubbing.
Reverend Jones!
Questionable dialogue.
Welcome to Sunday school.
And bizarrely dim-witted characters.
Oh, shit.
But with that said, this movie is somewhat of a marvel of independent horror filmmaking. It's so cheesy, it's so lame, it's so low budget, but the production value is actually pretty good. The gore effects are incredible. That's not to say that they look real, but they look awesome. The zombies look great for the most part, and the variety of cool locations make this movie feel a lot bigger than a lot of similar low-budget horror movies that might only take place in, like, one or two different locations. I would sincerely recommend this movie to aspiring filmmakers because it shows how much you can do with very little resources. This movie feels like a backyard passion project that just blew up way beyond that. For me anyways, watching The Dead Next Door reminds me of making shitty videos and short films with my buddies in high school. I would never call this movie good, because it isn't, but if you're into this type of movie, or if you aspire to create this type of movie, you're gonna have a good time, and you might even learn something.